Welcome back to another episode of Introductory Organic Chemistry. Today we have a very thorough episode where I go through reductive amination and amide synthesis. I tried to cover all of the main methods of doing this, including ones that aren't well summarized, so this might be a bit of a longer episode. Hopefully you enjoy it. Before we get into that, let's go through the practice problems that we assigned last lecture. So in this problem, I'd like you to propose a vitigre agent, a starting material, and conditions to get the following alkene. And so the conditions that I would have used is this cyclohexanone containing ketal. You can see that this could be derived from a 1,4-dione, and so we've just monoprotected it. This could then undergo a vitig reaction to get an alkene on the corresponding carbon in the 4 position. Now, you could also unmask this and get the ketone back out afterwards if you wanted to, you know, do further chemistry with it, or if your target had been a ketone in that position. In the next problem, I want you to propose conditions that would give you the Z-alkene product. And so if we wanted to use a HWE reaction, an HWE reaction, we would normally get the E-alkene. And so if we want to get this together, which is Zusamen, if you recall, we would have to use the still modification to the HWE. Or you could probably use a vitig reagent as well. However, I'm not 100% sure that you'd get the Z-alkene in that case. Okay, so we could do the still modification. The only reason I say that about the vitig is because normally you look at unstabilized vitigs, and I didn't cover in last lecture how the stabilization of the reagent leads to Z or E alkene formation. So this is why I'm just suggesting to use the still modification just to be sure. And so this would be relatively straightforward. If you recall, if we have a lithium salt present, we could just use DBU to get this alkene product, as this becomes a much more acidic proton in the presence of lithium. In the final problem, we have to do a multi-step synthesis where we start with this alpha-iodo ester, which can react with this phosphine, this phosphite, to give us an Arbuzov reaction losing iodomethane. Once we have this phosphonate, it can undergo Horner-Wadsworth-Emmons reactions. And because we don't have E or Z selective issues, because this is just going to give the same product if it adds one side to the other side, we don't have to worry about using fancy conditions. Okay, so with that, let's get to today's material, reductive amination and amide synthesis, just briefly at the end. And so normally, if you're going to make an amide via reductive amination, what you first do is you form an ammonium or an imine, and then you reduce this using sodium cyanoborohydride. Sodium cyanoborohydride is the most common reagent for this, which would be the most reactive except for triacetoxyborohydride. So the main reason that you do this is because if you use sodium cyanoborohydride, you don't typically reduce aldehydes or ketones, whereas sodium borohydride would. So if you're doing this all in one pot, which is normally how we do imine synthesis or ammonium synthesis, it's all done in one pot, then you don't want to be reducing any of your unreacted starting material. You only want to be reducing the product once it's formed. And so the rationale for this is actually because the N parameter of sodium cyanoborohydride is about 3 full units less than sodium borohydride, which is an order of magnitude of about 1,000. And so when this ammonium is formed, it's so reactive that it'll get reduced by a much weaker hydride donor. And so this is the rationale for this reagent. Now, there's a different scenario when we use the triacetoxyborohydride, which we'll get to after this slide. So the mechanism of this reaction is first we form the ammonium through the loss of water. The borohydride then just acts as a hydride donor, and then that reduces it to a secondary amine in this case. Now, I also mentioned here that if you're doing this practically, like you're actually doing this, if you have any boron-containing stuff present, it'll often form complexes with a nitrogen, and so you have to do chromatography or distillations to get rid of those typically, although some washes with base can also help remove them, because the hydroxide would form a borate complex, which is more stable than the nitrogen-boron complex in most cases. Okay, so some examples of this type of reduction include the reductive amination of this nucleoside derivative, where this NH2 is converted into an isopropylamine, which is a secondary amine. They reported a quantitative conversion. Then in this other case, this pyridine-containing compound is able to be converted to the methylamine secondary amine product. Now, if we wanted to use sodium triacetoxyborohydride, this can be used, but it has a higher N parameter, which is essentially the same as that of sodium borohydride. Now, industrially, this is preferred because for reductive aminations, we usually have an acid present. As showed in the previous slide, you can see acetic acid is present. This just helps transfer protons and gets the ammonium formation going more easily. And the problem is, if you add acetic acid to sodium borohydride, you'll actually convert the sodium borohydride to mono, di, and triacetoxyborohydride. However, the last hydride is not usually reactive enough to react with acetic acid. So this prevents large-scale reactions from being cumbersome and making a ton of gas as hydrogens being generated from the reaction of acid with borohydride. And so this is just kind of like a safety precaution thing, and it also is a practicality thing. Okay, so the other disadvantage is, if we look back at the previous slide, you can see that acid is being used in the presence of sodium cyanoborohydride, which means that some small amounts of hydrogen cyanide are generated, which is not good because hydrogen cyanide is super duper toxic. Now, an alternative method is to do rainy nickel with H2. This has been used in the Mignonac reaction, which is typically used to prepare primary amines. Now, if you'd prefer to use a different boron-based reagent instead of using a borohydride, you can use borane, and boranes will very easily reduce imines and ammoniums. Normally, when you use BH3, it's BH3-THF or BH3-dimethylsulfide, and there's several different complexes that exist in solutions. Now, there has been reports of aluminum amalgam being used as the reductive amination reductant. However, it was really hard for me to find references for this one, but here's one reference that I found. Okay, so some examples of the sodium triacetoxyborohydride mediated reduction include the functionalization of this steroid derivative, where you can see there's plenty of functional groups, ethers. Here we have a hemiacetal tertiary amine, and all of those are tolerated, and this is converted in half an hour very easily, even with a cyclobutanone. Another example is the conversion of this benzylamine with cyclohexanone to this secondary amine product. So this works quite well. Now, a very common approach that's used all the time in patent literature and occasionally in papers is the use of palladium on carbon with hydrogen in the presence of the amine and the ketone. Now, I'm not aware of any good reviews for this. If you have a really good review for this, please post it in the comments and I'll pin it. And so here I've listed several different references in case you're actually interested in using this chemistry so that you'll have some ideas of conditions to get started. So this is quite common in patent literature. It's used throughout, you know, Reaxys and SciFinder. You'll see it like everywhere. I also found one interesting example where instead of using hydrogen, they use triethylsilane. A lot of the time for reductions, there's an emerging method using trifluoroacetic acid and triethylsilane as like an H plus and an H minus source. And so this could be another strategy for doing reductions in general. Okay, so one example is the conversion of this N-Boc protected piperidinone. This is able to be reductively aminated using this benzylamine. Now, this is kind of a weird example because normally if you have palladium on carbon in the presence of hydrogen, you'll actually cleave benzylic ethers as well as like benzylamines. So this is kind of a special example, which is probably why their yield varied so much. Now, in this next example, we take the same starting material, but we treat it with ethanolamine, and ethanolamine is able to undergo reductive amination as well. And in this case, they observed quantitative conversion. So another way to make amines is the Eschweiler-Clarke reaction, which is the reductive methylation of primary or secondary amines. And so in this case, the aldehyde that's used is formaldehyde, and the reductant is actually formic acid. Now, the nice thing about formic acid is it also acts as the H plus source, which helps get chemistry going. And so as mentioned, if you take a secondary amine, you'll get a tertiary amine with one methyl group. And if you take a primary amine, you'll get a tertiary amine with two methyl groups. And so the mechanism for this reaction is first you form an amineum, as is typical for these reactions. Then formate just acts as a hydride donor, making CO2 as a byproduct, reductively methylating the amine. But because these are more reactive than the starting primary amine, if you recall, based on N parameters, which I'll put a card to here, the more substituted the amine, the more reactive it is. Now, in this case, this secondary amine is able to undergo another methylation, forming the tertiary amine as a product. Now, the advantage of this methodology and reductive amination in general is you won't form quaternary ammonium salts because you can't form a quaternary amineum. That's just like not a thing that happens, right? And so if you were to use something like iodomethane, these would totally just keep reacting, as was stated in an earlier lecture where I talk about sulfur and nitrogen nucleophiles, which I'll put in a card here. So some examples of the Eschweiler-Clarke reaction include the methylation of this alcohol-containing substrate, where you can see two methyl groups are added. Another example is the methylation of this pyrrolidine in the presence of a carboxylic acid and an alcohol. Only the methyl group goes to the nitrogen. So this is a nice reaction. Now there's a similar reaction called the Leuckart reaction, except instead of using formic acid and formaldehyde, they use ammonium formate. And so in this case, you take a ketone or an aldehyde in the presence of ammonium formate, and you may or may not need subsequent hydrolysis, and you'll get a primary amine. In the literature, I found many examples that utilize palladium on carbon as a catalyst, and this likely just converts the formamide intermediate into the final amine product. So most examples, though, in the literature were benzaldehydes or heteroaromatic aldehydes. So one really good example is this reference where they examine the effect of different drying reagents, equivalents of various reagents, and conditions on the overall transformation. So the mechanism of this reaction is as follows. First, an ammonium-based amineum forms. This is then reduced by formate as a hydride donor. This forms a primary amine, which in the presence of formic acid will just make a formamide. And so this is the desired product, but it's an intermediate because it'll keep reacting in situ. Also, the Wikipedia mechanism is really bad and overcomplicated. So if one of you wanted to go and redo that, that would be really awesome and I would appreciate it. Okay. So in the second step of this reaction, what we do is we just hydrolyze the formamide. So the formamide gets converted to an ammonium salt, and then the ammonium salt is able to get deprotonated, yielding the free base. As I stated in the previous slide, I just believe the palladium on carbon degrades the formamide to the amine directly. So some examples of this reaction include this great reaction from Orgson, where if you ever want to find a good procedure that could give you a place to start that works, Orgson is a good place if you can find a reaction. And so here they just convert acetophenone into this phenylethylamine. Now in this case, instead of using formamide, they use N-methylformamide, and so the methyl group is retained on the product. In their case, they actually undergo subsequent chemistry to deformulate this. But I thought it would be useful to show that if you just stop here, you'll just get the formamide product in most cases. Now, another approach, which is kind of a clever strategy, is to do a multi-step synthesis of an amine. So what you could do is you can form an amide first. And so you could use an activated acyl chloride. So in this case here, I have just like some X being like a leaving group. It could be an anhydride, etc. And so the amine will react. Once you form this amide, it can be reduced with LAH to give the secondary amine, but then you could just acylate it again and reduce it again. And so this could be really nice because if you're not comfortable doing amineum formation for multi-step reductive amination, you might get over-alkylation if you're not controlling things carefully or if you don't have the right equivalence of stuff. And so one strategy to get around that is just isolate at the first step, isolate the amide, reduce, isolate, re-acylate, isolate the acylated product, which is a confusing sentence, and further reduce that to get the tertiary amine product. And so you can imagine if you do this, you can create libraries of compounds without worrying about overreactivity, where two acyl groups would be added all at once, because those are a little bit less stable, although they can be prepared. So the contemporary way that we make amides is using coupling reagents. Personally, if you can get an acyl chloride and it's commercially available, those are usually easier to work with. But if you have sensitive conditions, like if you have alpha centers, for instance, you might need to use a milder reagent such as like DCC, and I'll talk about those on the next slide. Most of the time when you make an amide, you just use an amine, an acyl halide with a base and a catalyst such as DMAP, which is just like a nucleophilic catalyst, and this will give you the product. My method of choice is usually to take an acyl halide, usually an acyl chloride, with diisopropylethylamine as your base. The amine is like maybe in slight excess, and then a catalytic amount of DMAP, even like 5 to 15 milligrams will work. And if you ever monitor these by TLC, you can do it before you add the DMAP and after, and it'll be like smoking fast. You'll be able to tell it almost completely goes to conversion right away, because DMAP is just such a good catalyst. So if you have sensitive substrates, you can use the carboxylic acid instead of the acyl halide. And you could just use a coupling reagent to generate a good leaving group in situ. These essentially are just dehydrating agents. Most of these are driving to form ureas as byproducts, except for in the case of PIBOP, where triaminophosphine oxide is formed as the leaving group. Okay, and so I'm just going to show the mechanism for HATU, since HATU is probably the most common amongst these in the literature based on my searches on Reaxys. So there's also kind of some neat functionality with the pyridine of HATU, which you don't see in PIBOP, and it accelerates the rate a little bit. So initially, a base is going to deprotonate the carboxylic acid, forming the carboxylate. The carboxylate can then undergo a nucleophilic attack on this amineum, forming this tetrasubstituted product, which can then eliminate off this benzotriazole as a leaving group. hydroxybenzotriazole as a leaving group. Then once we form this intermediate, this is a good leaving group, so the benzotriazole, hydroxybenzotriazole, is able to come back in, displace this as a leaving group, and you can actually isolate these hydroxybenzotriazole type products if you want. Once you've formed this, and you can test this by TLC usually if you've got your carboxylic acid in there, once you see no carboxylic acid is left, then what you do is you add in your amine, which could be primary or secondary. This is going to undergo nucleophilic attack, displacement of the hydroxybenzotriazole, giving you your amide product. And here you can see that the NH of the protonated adduct actually forms a hydrogen bond to the pyridine of the hydroxybenzotriazole. And so this is kind of the rationale for why this works a little bit better than PIPOP does. Okay, so some examples of amide synthesis include the coupling of this FMOC-protected amino acid glycine. FMOC is just this fluorinone methanol group. It can be deprotected under basic conditions. We haven't talked about FMOC, so I'm just highlighting that right now. Then we have this cyclic polyamide, polyamine, which is then able to be functionalized at the unreacted position, giving us this amino acid adduct product. In this next example, we have this 1,2,4-triazole, and this is able to be coupled with this Bach-protected amino acid derivative, giving this as our product. So with this, I'd like to assign three practice problems for this lecture. In the first case, take this alkene-containing ketone and propose some sort of reductive amination conditions to give this product on the right. In the next case, I want you to show, starting with styrene, how you could convert styrene into acetophenone. There's several different approaches. I'll talk about some that are more direct and some that are easier to do with what we've already talked about, and then convert acetophenone into this phenylethylamine. In the next final problem, I'd like you to show over a multi-step synthesis how you could convert benzene into this compound shown on the right. You're also allowed to use 1 and 2 carbon building blocks if you're wondering about the methyl groups or this ethyl group. You can start with 1 and 2 carbon building blocks, that's fine, and you're allowed to use every other reagent that we've talked about so far in the course. And so with that, I hope that this has been a really useful video about reductive amination and amide synthesis. It would really help out the channel if you left a like and subscribed. If you have any questions, comment down below. And hey, you better have a great day. See ya.